This is Radio on TV. In this week's program, we have
Karma Jurmi, the CEO of Araya Zamla Organic Packers. The company packages buckwheat flour and produces herbal tea. And we'll find out more about him and his company as we talk with him. So first of all, tell us, Karma, where are you from?
Let me go with my name. My name is Karma Jurmi, aka people call me Ura Pagla also at the same time. And I'm from a place called Ura in Bhutan.
And then you decided to set up a company there.
Yes, yes. Actually, it's not my company. It's my late father's company. Uh-huh. And then we have been doing packaging thing for last almost 18 years. Mm. But yes, comparing to the outside market or outside packagers, we are little like a child thing.
Okay. And before we go further into it, tell us, what were you doing before you entered into this packing business?
Now, I'm a jack of all trades, so I did so many things. Mm-hmm. Of all, I was a trucker. I drove a 10-wheeler truck for last 16 years in a company, in two companies actually, BECPL and Tashi Commercial Corporation. And from there, my father came down once, and then he saw me driving a big truck, big lorry. Then he said, no. You have to come home because I can afford to be poor, but further poor, you know, losing a son. Uh-huh. So he bought me up. He kidnapped me up, actually. Uh-huh. And then I was at Ura, and then he put me into this medicinal herbs to learn more.
You started to farm that medicinal herbs?
Yes, uh-huh. Yes. And we started with two seedlings of medicinal herbs, uh-huh. Especially a herb called Sasuriya Lapa. Uh-huh. We Bhutanese, we call it Shafuruta. Uh-huh. And then with those two seedlings, my late father got it from a late Dungso Sengi Namge. So through him, my dad got two seedlings, and then we started cultivating. Then it was a rare herb. Uh-huh. So we cultivated, and it went better, and then we picked up, and then we started doing into acres of... Uh-huh. Sasuriya Lapa. Mm-hmm. And then after some time, the MAP, Mr. Chetila, he came there, he saw the herbs, then he insist on buying the seeds. Mm-hmm. And then at first my father didn't agree with him because he said like it's giving away the business to someone. But later, after a second thought, I don't know what into him, he said like, okay, we'll give you the seeds. So we sold the seeds to the MAP, the personal Chitila sir, and then through Chitila sir, it was distributed throughout the district, mm-hmm. throughout the Bhutan. Mm-hmm. And then people started doing that Sasuriya cultivation, and then they were making, they were growing properly. But the problem came when, because we had a very small window of market, mm-hmm. that was the MSP. Right now, they call MSP, but before we were told that it is called ITMS, Indigenous Medicines. So, and then since the window of market was very small, and the production was very high, so there was nothing we could do. We couldn't sell it to India, which was giving us very low rates. Like actually, comparing to their rates, they have given us more. But for us, comparing with the MSB's rate, theirs were much less. So then my father said, like, why don't you do something with this? Because since now people are all growing medicinal herbs, we are having problem with the raw material. We have raw materials, now look for a market. Then I looked around, it was nowhere. I mean, like, I checked in the internet, I checked throughout the internet.
But there was a market in India.
Yes, there was, in a company called Dabur. Mm-hmm. Dabur, they make typical homeopathic medicines. Okay. For but them,
they were not paying well.
They were paying us then 124 per kilograms. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, we were getting 300 Ultram per kilograms in Bhutan. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, when they said 124, it was in tons. When we had a small talk with the Dabur official, they said they want in tons.
Okay.
And then I said, how many tons are we talking about? They said, more than 10 tons a year, and which was impossible because it was a small experimental project, which we all did. Mm. But later, Then I looked around here and there, and then I had this crazy idea of making it into a tea.
Mm-hmm.
Because in MSP, they are making 49 different medicines out of this Sasuri Alapa. So I thought if we make a tea out of it, it'll have the exact dosages mm-hmm. of your intake. And then at the same time, you know, if you do it in a, diversify the product, not mm-hmm. as a raw material, but as a product, it might go well.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it did. It did picked up. But the thing now, again, the another problem is packaging. Because we, so as far as I know, in Bhutan, we don't have much packaging entrepreneurs. So what happened was I had to take it all
but
the way.
You are a packaging company.
Yes, right? before I mean like I'm before we really went into it, packaging.
Mm-hmm.
So we were doing a small tits and bits here and there. So I had to take it all the way to Calcutta to
mm-hmm.
pack a certain amount of Sansuria
mm-hmm.
Ruta, let's say Ruta
tea. But why couldn't you do it in the country?
Actually, to be very blunt and to be very, you know, straight to your question, it's the financial thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then to invest into a machine which you require just to make 100,000 of tea bags a year,
mm-hmm.
is not as much feasible to invest in that machine.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we take it all the way down. Before we used to before we were given a chance to grow by MSP to pack it with them. But after some time, they discontinued their help.
Mm-hmm.
So we had to take it all the way to Calcutta to pack it.
Mm-hmm. So is it profitable to package it in Calcutta and bring
profit,
it to Bhutan?
Okay, profit-wise, you mean going to Calcutta and coming back? No,
mm-hmm.
The profit is 50-50, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have to take the raw materials all the way from here and then
mm-hmm.
again bring all the packed materials all the way from Calcutta.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did was I packed only tea bags down there.
Mm-hmm.
I packed the tea bags, put them in boxes, and then I bring it back.
Mm-hmm.
And then here, at my small unit at Ura, I ask the local farmers' daughters and sons, they come up there and then they handpick every tea bags and then make them into 20 group batches
mm-hmm.
and then they pack it at home only.
Mm-hmm. So before we go into to talk more about your company and what you are doing just now, and you have a song lined up for us. Would you like to dedicate that song to anybody?
Yeah. Actually, I like to dedicate it to my wife who is expecting,
mm-hmm.
my mother, and all the people, most of the people who don't know me, and all the people who knows me.
Welcome back. We are in conversation with Karma Jurmi, the CEO of Araya Zamla Organic Packers. The company packages buckwheat and produces tea from herbal medicines. So Karma, while you are trying to package buckwheat and produce medicinal tea, what kind of support did you receive from related agencies and departments?
Well, since I was the first person to do all these things, I got so many help and so many from so many ministries and so many sector heads and all. So to name few, one would be BCCI, who had been helping me from day one. MSP for making me go on from buckwheat to herbal tea. AMC for customizing a machine, they call it buckwheat line. Post harvest for helping me how to pack Bafra. There are so many, they are countless. So, but the biggest support I got was from my mother, who, after knowing that bucket is not a, you know, when we are making only 15 yildrum from each bag, after knowing also, she said, no, this is what your father has started to keep on doing till the time when you feel that it is, in fact, a dead business.
So are you just doing it for the sake to keep up what your father had started, or, you know, you actually see a potential there?
Actually, yes. One is that. One is because of my father. Second is that I, being a Bhutanese, I feel that we Bhutanese should eat something different. Eat something of a higher quality. Eat something, you know, have a better product. So we started this, we in a sense, DAMC, DAMC's director, I think Doji Darul or something, and AMC's program coordinator, Mr. Karma. So we sat together, we talked, and after after a talk, we finalized that we should go on with organic buckets. And then with the help of NOP, they identified the land in Gumdar. And then from there, till that time, I was not fully, you know, decided whether I should go on with this or not. But when I was down there and buying the raw materials, there was an old lady who came, who bought the, I bought her thing, and then she took the money. And while taking the money, she said, "Thiri, live long. Because you are buying our product, now we can buy something of what we need." So that really touched me. And then that is the one of so many reasons why I don't want to stop this. And that was the main thing, because I felt as if she blessed me. And we came here, we started doing buckwheat with the, you know, officials. I sometimes felt as if that I am not a part of Araya Zamla, but a part of agriculture ministry, you know, because wherever I turn around, I see agriculture people, AMC, DAMC, you know, all these people together. And then sometimes I forget that I am a private entrepreneur. And sometimes I listen to whatever they say, and then I decide on this, which is, in fact, as a businessman, not so sound.
So what kind of market is there? How much of buckwheat flour do you supply in a market like Thimphu, or for that matter, Bhutan?
We started with 800 metric tons of raw buckwheat from Gumdar. And after procuring that, we brought it all the way to AMC. Then they were helping us without any charges. They were giving it on. They were bettering the machines they had. And then we did it, and we got a output of almost 4 tons of flours, which was later packed into boxes, supported by DAMC. And while doing so, we bought those boxes, we came to the to Thimphu, we started marketing. Before we did that, we came here to do a market research. That time, the market order was almost 6-7 tons. But when we bought the reality came, we bought the buckwheat here, and then when we start to, you know, supply them, they all turned back. They said, "My goodness, where will I keep this many buckwheats? Can you do it in batches?" then yes, I could do it in batches, but I need the money to go and buy a second lot of promised lot of sweet buckwheat. But at the same time, they said it'll take them a year to process, to finish the product. So here and there, you know, like with 24 boxes here and 100 boxes there and a ton of boxes here, it went to almost 3 tons, almost 3 tons. And then the market just saturated. Mm-hmm. Then I was out of business. I had nothing to do. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't even, in fact, I couldn't even lift the hucks from the AMC because market got, in one go, it went saturated. You know, mm-hmm. it saturated in one time. Then I had some buckwheat flours with me. And
which means once people consumed your buckwheat, they didn't want to buy a second time or?
No, I it's like this. My understanding is that when I started packaging, I thought I'll do it with a less profit and sell more products. But I was wrong. It is, in fact, Indian mentality, how they do business. They have very less
margin,
profit margin. But they sell more, and they could sell more because they are more than us. So when I came here, it didn't go that well, that way. And the other thing is, Bhutanese consumers are not so yet ready for a better product, because
why do you say so?
Yeah, because no, I feel that way because. When I give them my product, they say I have mixed this, mixed that, and all.
Oh, of course, there was a criticism where you might have mixed.
Yeah, and then this is what they said, and because it's
so whiter. Why is your product so finer than the one we get from the villages?
It's because of the AMC machine. They have that segregator. They have the destoner. They have dehuxer.
Mm-hmm.
And back at home in the villages, all we have is that water mill. Which you just put it in and then it grinds.
Mm.
So making it 40% husk and 60% flour,
mm-hmm.
which will be darker in color.
Mm-hmm.
So ours, it's done by AMC, dehusks, everything is, you know, like cleaned.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, I'll not say 100% husk free,
mm-hmm.
you know, because there are a few husks that they jump and mm-hmm. They go into the kernels. And then I say it's 98% husk free.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it's
whiter. That's why it's whiter and finer.
And then finer because we don't grind them. Mm-hmm. We mill them.
Mm-hmm.
There are two things in here. Mm-hmm. Because while grinding it, you're just, you know, grinding it. But here, the AMC have provided me with two hammer millers, which has nothing to do with, you know, like grinding and all. It just hammers it.
Mm-hmm.
So while hammering it, it becomes finer.
Mm-hmm.
So the quality is much, much finer. And cleaner and whiter, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not say cleaner and finer, but since the local people, buckwheat we buy from the locals are a little darker,
mm-hmm.
and ours is a little whiter, so they feel that I have added something in it.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, there is nothing in it, and there cannot be anything because sweet buckwheat is supposed to be a gluten-free product, and maida or whatever are with gluten.
Mm-hmm.
So how can I sell a product saying it's gluten free? Okay, had I been in somewhere else, our neighboring country or anywhere, I could have, because being a businessman, it's all you have got to do is sell.
Mm-hmm.
But in India, you can do this because there are crores and crores and crores of people. So so even if it is one time business, it is like almost 10-20 crores of people will eat it. So in that way, so in Bhutan, I can't do this
mm-hmm.
because Bhutan is a very small thing. And then I leave my business on word of mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So you eat my product. If it is good, you can let me know. And then I make more products. So ours is nothing to do with selling.
Mm-hmm.
Ours is an understanding between the consumer and the producer.
So earlier you said that Bhutan has a limited market for the packaging that you do, no? And then, now have you tried looking for a market outside?
Market outside, yes. I was fortunate because I think Agriculture Ministry and BCCI in cooperate with, they have sent me till Taiwan. So when I went there, I showcased my products, I showed them, and then the Chinese, they loved it, they liked it. And then, but now the thing is, it's a flaw and it weighs a lot. So even if you, even if the Chinese people wants more, it'll be a problem for me to send it all the way down there, because it'll be heavier. And then I'm not comfortable with putting it in a container, because when you put it in a container, you have to have minimum of, I believe minimum of few tons. And few tons, I don't have market in yet in Taiwan. So I was again taken to Nepal by BCCI, and then we went there, we showcased our thing. There were people from Pakistan, there were people from Sikkim, and there were people from Nepal only. So we all, and all of us bought sweet buckwheat. And when I opened my packet, which was in a blue box, I opened my packet and I showed my product. Their product and my product is like their, the local product and my product. So they asked me how I did it. Then I said, like, I shared my technology. It was actually funded by ECMOT. Then there I showed them, and then I shared my technologies, how I did it, how we did it here. And then the Nepalese people, they came. They said they get it at 60 rupee.
In Nepal?
Yeah,
60 rupee. Whereas you sell for 100?
150 into 1.5. So it should be around 180, I think. I don't know.
That is three times the price of...
No, our Ngiltrum is 150, and theirs is, you know, like lesser 60. Than ours. So I sold them at my rate, 150, which was multiplying to their rate. And then they said, then I said, like, your buckwheat and my buckwheat has a big difference. One is your buckwheat has some stone particles in it and some husk particles in it. Meanwhile, my buckwheat is pure, without husk, and specially grown in high altitude. And then they saw the packaging, and at the same time, they liked the packaging, the idea of packaging. It's not just a plastic bag. With, we can see the flowers, common flowers sold here. So ours is in boxes, and then they like the packaging. They like the way I packed it, because it's 1 kilogram and then it's packed into two, which means like you can use one and you can still have the other fresh.
So even if you had a market there in Nepal and Pakistan, the transportation is the problem.
Yes, yes.
As it is, your price is high.
High.
And then you have to transport all the way to Nepal and Pakistan. So do you see a chance that your buckwheat will do well there?
No.
No.
No, because I can't go below the rate I have already already using in the market. Because when we first bought buckwheat from the farmers, we they didn't charge us. We gave them a 35 mule drum per day, which is like approximately 1.6 kgs. So that time I was buying buckwheat at 35 mule drum per 1.6 kgs. Then next year, I revised it into 50, which was a mistake, actually. I should have gone to 40. But I thought I was making good profit. Why don't the farmers have the better share also? I gave them at 50. And then after a year, they charge it. Now the farmers are becoming more and more, you know.
They want more now. Now, there are also other people like who want to get into this business of packaging, you know, buckwheat flour.
So,
how do you want to deal with it?
No, I think if anyone is there in Bhutan who wants to do buckwheat, want to pack buckwheat, I think all those people, a government should do something to root them all together, you know, make them sit together. And then after sitting together, let me rephrase this. It's like if five of us enter into this same business, it's a societal thing. Because then you will not be making any profit. The farmer, since you're not making any profit, you will not be able to pay your suppliers, raw material suppliers, that much. So in that way, you're killing the farmer at the same time you're dying. And you're also killing your other... So now the government should, you know, like bring all these people together, put them in a room, make them sit, and then among themselves decide. Because buckwheat flour is not the only product we can make from buckwheat. There are so many things. The husks can be converted into, you know, like false ceilings, soundproof, and then into pillows, mattresses, mattress covers, car seats. There are so many things you can do with husks. So one guy goes with the husks. So whatever products had to be made from the husks, if that guy makes it. And likewise, okay, now one guy produces flour. He'll only do flour. And then the third one will do the another thing, which is like soba noodles, you know, buckwheat ngacharagi, our own puta. And then they can even have frozen kule, make baked kule, and then freeze it and then pack it.
So or, in other words, somebody can add value to it. Somebody can use the byproducts.
In that way, it will be win-win situation for all the bucket workers. So if you, if I have money, I invest in this. And if somebody doesn't have money but looks around and bring in money and invest in this, all people working for one product. And I tell you, from the 100% of Bhutanese, 70 stays at the in the farm areas, rural areas. Only 30 stays in the urban areas. From 30, 25 doesn't eat buckwheat. Only the 10% eats buckwheat. From 10%, only the 5% would love buckwheat and eat it as a daily meal. So when we are talking about 5% of what we are, I feel that if five entrepreneurs work together, I mean like five entrepreneurs work on one product, it'll have a, I feel that it'll have a problem with the market, how to enter the market and all.
So in the end, it will boil down to what you said earlier, where they will drown themselves and they in the process.
They will pull
other people along with them.
It's not a technical term, but I feel that we should call this kind of entrepreneurs societal entrepreneurs.
Okay. So there is no room for other...
No, I can't say there is no room, but they can come in. But this is, you know, like...
But it has to be more organized.
Okay. If it is organized, it'll be... It'll be they'll be making money, I'll be making money. All the people who are coming into buckwheat business will make money.
Okay.
If all of us do everything the same way, I don't think it'll make money. Any of us will leave.
Okay. On that note, we wish you all the best, that you do well.
Thank you.
With your business. And this has been another episode of Radio on TV. Do join us every week. And I'm Ashok Tirwa. This is goodbye for now.